Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh, my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like never. Worship your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before, your holy name. You're rich in love and you're slow to anger. Your name is great and your heart is kind. For all your goodness I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. So bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like your holy name. Bless you, time has come. Still my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and then forevermore. Forevermore. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like never before. Oh my soul, I worship Your holy name. Come bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh my soul, worship His holy name. Worship Your holy name, Lord, I worship Your holy name. Sing like never. Your holy name, Jesus. worship your holy name. Worship your holy
faithfulness, O God, my Father, there is no shadow of turning with Thee. Thou changest not, Thy compassions, they fail not. As Thou hast been, Thou forever will be. Great is Thy faithfulness, great is Thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, Thy hand hath provided. Great is Thy faithfulness, Lord.
Great is Thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Brothers and sisters, be stand as we begin this act of worship and receive the body.
I am the resurrection and the life, says the Lord. He who believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live. And whosoever lives and believes in me shall never die.
The hour is coming, and now is, when the dead will hear the voice of the Son of God, and those who hear will live.
We brought nothing into this world, and it is certain we shall carry nothing out. The Lord gave, and the Lord has taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord.
If we live, we live to the Lord. And if we die, we die to the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. For to this end Christ died and lived again, that he might be Lord both of the dead and of the living.
Our Savior Christ Jesus abolished death, brought life and immortality to light through the gospel.
I am the first and the last. I am he who lives and was dead. And behold, I am alive forevermore. And I have the keys of death and of hell.
Because I live, you will live also.
And death shall be no more. Neither shall there be mourning, nor crying, nor pain. For the first things are passed away. Brothers and sisters, I welcome us here at the James Street Methodist Church Chapel for the service of thanksgiving for the life of our dear William Eustace Aline. I invite us to remain standing as we're able to, as we sing our opening hymn, How Great Thou Art. When I look down from lofty mountain grandeur and hear the brook and feel the gen, then sings my soul. That on the cross, my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away. Then sings my soul.
And loving God, we turn to you in the sorrow and the grief of our bereavement, praying that, Lord, we may find the strength we need in your sustaining grace. So even as we mourn the death of one whom we knew and loved, we pray, Lord, that we may not be overcome by this trial, but we may hold fast, trusting in your goodness and mercy. Assure us, O God, that death is not the end of those who trust in you. And may our hearts be so composed in the Holy Spirit that all fear and bitterness may be swallowed up in the light and peace you give to all your troubled children. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty and eternal God, who by your Holy Spirit you minister to us in our weakness, and by the victory of your Son, Jesus Christ, have given us the pledge of eternal life, lift us, we pray, above our present distress and trial, and shed the light of your grace and glory upon us, through the same Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Friends, we are met today in this solemn moment to commend William Eustace Alleen into the hands of Almighty God, our Heavenly Father. who sent his Son, Jesus Christ, to be our Redeemer, by whose stripes we are healed, and in whose name alone do we have salvation. Let us then recall to mind the life of our dear brother, and in humble trust hear the words of Holy Scripture. So at this moment, I invite us to stand as we're able to once again, as we sing the hymn, Father, lead me day by day. Sisters, and at this moment we'll invite Russell Clark to come and bring us the eulogy.
Life of Willie Allen is a collaborative appreciation with contributions from great friends and family, Peter Green, and Wendy Allen were the scribes in chief, to which I add my voice. I am decidedly honored to be given this privilege to deliver it. I am Russell Clark, old friend of this family. It is with a strange amalgam of grief and gratitude for the life of our beloved William Eustace Allen, SCMBCH, that we are here to honor and pay tribute as we collectively celebrate him, his talent, impactful and productive life, and contributions to his family, friends, and Barbados. One of his erstwhile colleagues, remain unnamed, said he was a real Bajan treasure. We wish to thank all of you, including those online, for participating in this service of thanksgiving and appreciation for the life of William Eustace Allen. Willie, as he was affectionately known, was a husband, a father, a grandfather, a great-grandfather, a friend, a colleague, and above all, a true Barbadian, Bajan to the bone. He came into this world on the 21st day of November, 1932, to the late Alita Aurora Allen, née Blackman, and William Colburn Allen. He was married to the late Elsie Allen, née Weeks, for 43 plus years. They were the parents of Wendy, Irwin, Wallace, grandparents of Jamie and Kirk, and great-grandparents of Cassius, Adonis, and Star. Willie and Cece worked hard and tirelessly to provide a pleasant home, a good education for their children, and to facilitate a comfortable way of living for their family, while also doing their best to help others. From an early age, he was fascinated with pictures, black and white, of course, and by extension, still photography. According to family recollections, as a young boy, he would photograph people, dogs, cats. Such was the compelling allure that he acquired a prize $5, according to Mr. Green, $5 Brownie fast shutter box camera when he was a mere teenager. This was Kodak's attempt to meet the mass audience. And they had developed that camera at the turn of the century, but it was still popular and is a collector's item. Thus, his inclination towards still photography was fostered early in life. His interest and curiosity in photography was further focused by having periodic access to the Advocate newspaper while growing up, thinking that he too could take and process some of the photographs he had seen in that broadsheet. Those were the seminal exposures to developing his craft. His apprenticeship at the Advocate was over within a few months as his enthusiasm for photojournalism grew and he was hired on staff soon after. From modest, humble beginnings, years later he developed an enviable private clientele or clientele until, along with his wife, he established his own company, Willie Allen Associates Photography. The company catered not only to individual customers, but also to newspapers. Apart from the Advocate, there were the Daily News, the Bajan Magazine, and later the Nation, along with several private establishments. He developed a business acumen that saw him being the accredited lensman for many overseas publications, like the Associated Press, the Times, the New York Times, the Telegraph, the Observer, and Black Entertainment, Enterprise Magazine, sorry, as well a number of regional newspapers. He also did contractual work over several decades for successive local public sector tourism organizations. I think you know them. Particularly the Barbados Tourist Board, the Barbados Board of Tourism, and later the Barbados Tourism Authority. His was a wide angle view and aperture on the types of photography he would do. Willie was the go-to cameraman in the region, and particularly in Barbados, when it came to covering quote-unquote big and important events. who was a household name that was synonymous with reliable and creative still photography. He was simply tops in his field. We'll quote Gladstone Holder, who was the chief information officer in Barbados in the 70s, when he observed that Willie Adding is, quote, the quintessential photographer around here. From coverage of state visits of the monarchy, presidents and prime ministers, formal banquets and government events, special occurrences, to weddings, christenings, church services, sporting events, often cricket, and cultural events, speech days, horse riding, horse racing, Willie was the preferred lensman in his heyday. Even though he functioned in a private capacity, the Barbados government, through its information service, utilized his expertise for many years. So did some other regional governments on grand occasions. Willie worked along with he worked along with and beside other local stalwarts in the field of photography. You know the names, the likes of the late Paul Mandeville, Pierce Tappin, Cyprian Latouche Sr., Cyprian Latouche Jr., Gordon Brooks, Felix Carr, Roy Beyer, Tony Lynch, and of course, Ronnie Carrington, who today continues to maintain the high standards of the many facets of photography, as did the others aforementioned. Not to be overlooked, however, are those he apprenticed and mentored. Alison Cumberbatch, Jeffrey Atherley, Stephen Smith, Charles Grant, and Willie's proteges, Charlie Pitt and Christopher Brandis, and I'm sure there are others, as they were among the photographers who also played a significant role in his professional life. He was affable, meticulous in his work, whether it was planning and covering any assignment. He was a consummate professional in work and image. He exuded understated confidence and was always the part, right down to his attire. Willie delivered. So it's no surprise that in the course of his lifetime, he was acknowledged and awarded national honors for outstanding and exceptional work. He was conferred with the prestigious Barbados Centennial Honor in 2001, the Silver Crown of Merit in 2010, and the Tourism Lifetime Achievement Award in 2018. I think that was a little late. All richly deserved. He was also accredited as a Justice of the Peace. I never needed to use him, though. The core staple of his work, perhaps, the bread and butter, was weddings. There must be 1,000 couples who relive their special day, compliments of Willie's coverage. And Linda and I thank him for that also. Willie lived a full life that was at times adventurous and at times dangerous, because he was passionate about photography and shooting the photos that were needed for a particular assignment. He has shared stories about close calls while flying in small aircraft, circling in a small plane over a human tragedy, the Cubana airline plane crash, being held house arrest along with other members of press on another island during a political crisis, the Grenada invasion. Known also for some iconic images like the three Concorde aircraft on the tarmac at Grantley Adams International Airport. I don't think three Concorde have been serially assigned any one airport like that, but really got that shot. And of course, the famous pictures of Garfield Sobers threading the cover side for four. I think y'all know that shot. It's a famous shot with Sir Gary. He spent great times with family and friends, exercised often, enjoyed horse racing with his late cousin Arnold Allen and others, played dominoes with Peter Green and many in the Barbados Government Information Service Dominoes Group and beyond, watched cricket and soccer avidly during major events for each sport, and in his later years worshipped in church more regularly as he had done in his formative years. CC and Willie's home was an open house, so the younger set know this. Yeah, I was part of the younger set. I was. And their children entertained and caucused with friends galore with their parents' jovial support. He was an amiable, generous man, well-meaning, with goodwill to all and full of good humor. To his friends, he was a trusted buddy, a confidant, a sounding board to many. Really, rest in peace and rise in glory on that great day. Willie Allen, you will be missed, but we are glad we had this time together. And until we meet again, the cycle continues. As day turns to night, life's tapestry woven both day and light, dark and light. Rest in peace, dear Willie. Your journey complete, and your spirit, may your spirit rise in glory, eternal and sweet. On behalf of all of us, we extend sincerest condolences to Wendy, Irwin, Wallace, and the whole Allen family. May you be comforted in the knowledge that God will continue to encircle you, protect you, and hold you in his arms.
So we bless God for the words of the life of our dear brother. And so at this moment, we'll have a solo done by Alex Cage.
Hello, my name is Alex, and I've been asked to do this song that I'm told is one of William's favorite songs. This is What a Wonderful World.
Blessing day. patterns of rainbow are so pretty in the sky, and also on the faces of people passing by. Well, I see friends shaking hands, saying how to do. They're really saying, I
Alex. And so we'll continue in a time of tribute. And so we'll have a tribute by Jamie Aline Bermudez, after which we'll have another tribute by Wallace Aline on behalf of Claude and Cynthia Ashby. And after that, we'll have an expression of thanks by Wendy Aline.
As Willie's granddaughter, Jamie Aline Bermudez, I've been reflecting on the recent visit we had with Granddad. My husband Chris and our kids, Cassius and Adonis, had an opportunity to meet their great-granddad for the first time, and we all had the chance to share some special moments with him exactly a month before his passing. Granddad will always have a special place in my heart, never forgetting all the summers I spent with him and Grandma Cece as a little girl. Although saying goodbyes can be difficult, I'm happy that we are able to reminisce on the great times we share together. May Granddad rest in peace, surrounded by the love and cherished memories he created with each of us.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you so much for coming. So this tribute is from one of Daddy's friends who now lives in Atlanta, Georgia. His name is Claude Ashby, and his spouse is Cynthia Ashby. I do remember them growing up. So I'll just read what Claude wrote. He says, "Just watching Willie Allen at work made my brother Roddy and me photographers. How to set up a photo mentally, that is, how to foresee the best outcome before clicking the shutter, and therefore the precise moment at which to click it, is a work of art. And indeed, really was, and probably still is, a master of that art. In fact, Willie provided the inspiration that enabled me as a teenager to win a first prize and also the Challenge Cup in the photography section of the old Agricultural and Arts Exhibition in Queens Park in 1958. Watching Willie at work one afternoon in his old dark room in the Dalkeith area so many years ago was the best lesson I ever had in darkroom technique in the age of wet photography. Printing, developing, fixing, and drawing. Indeed, that was a totally different era from present-day digital photography. Willie Allen, although he was some 10 years older, became a very close friend, a friendship that grew stronger with time and was reaffirmed when I last spent several hours with him just 3 months ago. A friend who was close as a brother, and I will always remember him that way. Thank you, Claude. I just want to add a couple of words to you guys out there. I just want you to know that Willie was to be comforted to know that when I came also, like Jamie, to visit Daddy just before he passed, I didn't know it was going to happen. But for those of you, to let you know that in comfort, he did enjoy his last meal, which I was ordered to get. I shouldn't say last meal, but his last enjoyable meal was his pudding and sauce and his fish and chips. Literally, when I left the house that day, he said in the morning, I said, Dad, are you hungry? He says, yeah. What do you want? Pudding and sauce. I says, okay, I'll hold on, some fish and chips too. When I came back, without it, it was not pretty. So I had to go out and got him, and trust me, he ate all of it. So hope you guys are comforted to know that. The last thing I want to say, if you guys didn't notice, I am actually wearing a couple of the pins that Russell mentioned that Daddy received. So in his honor, I wore these. I believe these are the two of the medals that he received. So rest in peace, my father. I love you. Actually, rest in power. Thank you.
Everyone. I am Willie's daughter, Wendy Allen. On behalf of my brothers Irwin and Wallace, we thank you, Bishop, the Reverend Derek Richards, Jem Hinkson, and June Moore, for arranging communion service for Daddy at home so that he and I at times could worship with you. We also thank Father Gilberto Hines and the congregation of St. John's Episcopal Church in Queens, New York, for praying for our father when they learned that he had been hospitalized. He heard the video clip recording of your prayers for him. He smiled when he heard it. The persons who have shown in various ways their regard for Daddy as a professional photographer and as a person over the years are too numerous to mention. We sincerely thank you. However, we must not be remiss and need to express our gratitude to some of you. Since my siblings and I have been living in the U.S. for the past 30 plus years, when it became necessary, we have relied on Wendy A. Allen and Maxine Wolcott to provide his care, to provide for his care as his primary caregivers at home. We will always be grateful to you both for the ways in which you went above and beyond to ensure excellent care for Daddy. We extend our thanks to Dr. Trevor Martyr, his practice assistant, Elsa Ward, Dr. Sauda Mohammed, Dr. Allison Mears, and Dr. Karen Padmore for their medical care for Daddy. Their expertise, compassion, and dedication have been exceptional. We appreciate immensely the assistance and support, even more since Daddy's passing, from Annette and Raquel Roberts, Auntie Nola Mears and family, Andre and Karen Shaw, Peter and Norma Green, Russell Clark, Gersine Carter, Rodney Lashley, Dominic Goodfellow, Addison Cumberbatch, Jeffrey Atherley, and all pallbearers. thank you for your kindness. Special thanks to the family and friends, you know who you are, who have remained close to Daddy, occasionally visiting, calling, checking on him, sending or delivering fruit baskets, home-cooked food or meals, home-baked goods, pears or other produce from their gardens, inviting him for Christmas family lunch, to dine at gatherings with special friends or more important occasions, playing dominoes or watching cricket with him at home, taking him to lunch, the Crane for breakfast, to Oystens and on trips around the island. In conclusion, we are thankful for everyone who is here with us in this church or online, and for those who are keeping our family in their thoughts and prayers. God's peace be with you, Daddy.
So friends, we will continue in this time of worship and we will enter into the ministry of the word, and our responsive psalm will be taken from Psalm 46, which will be read by Annette Roberts. The epistle lesson will be read from Romans chapter 8, verse 31 to 39. That will be read by Wallace Aline, and the gospel lesson, which will be read from the book of St. John, chapter 14, reading verses 1 to 6 and verse 27, which will be read by Irwin Aline. And during the reading of the gospel lesson, we will be invited to stand as we're able to.
Good morning. A reading from the Word of God, Psalm 46. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth should change, the mountains shake in the heart of the sea, though its waters roll and foam, though the mountains tremble with its turmoil. Selah, the city of God, the holy habitation of the Most High. God is in the midst of the city. It shall not be moved. God will help it when the morning dawns. The nations are in an uproar. The kingdoms totter. He uttered his voice. The earth melted. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. Amen.
Again. This reading is from Romans 8, verses 31 to 39. What then are we to say about these things? If God is for us, who is against us? He who did not withhold his own son, but gave him up for all of us, will he not with him also give up everything else? Who will bring any charges against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is to condemn? It is Christ Jesus who died, yes, who was raised, and who is the right hand of God. Who indeed intercedes for us? Who will separate us from the love of Christ? Will hardship, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or peril, or sword? As it is written, for your sake we are being killed all day long. We are accounted as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor death, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God. In Christ Jesus, our Lord. Amen. Thank you.
To St. John. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house, there are many dwellings. If it were not so, what I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, so that where I am, there you all will be. And you know the way to the place where I am going. Thomas said to him, Lord, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way? And Jesus said to him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not let them be afraid. Thanks be to God. And thank you all for being here. Amen.
Friends, you may be seated, and at this moment you may be blessed by the anthem sung by the James Street Methodist Church Choir.
let it be. Brothers and sisters, I greet you. In the name of Jesus Christ, head of the church and savior of the whole world. And I take this opportunity on behalf of the people called Methodists across the length and breadth of Barbados, particularly the members of the James Street Methodist Church, of which Brother Willie was a faithful and devoted member. I extend to you, the family, our deepest condolences during this, your time of bereavement. To his daughter, Wendy, sons, Wallace and Irwin, other grandchildren, great-grandchildren, relatives, including Sister Annette, and all of his dear friends and associates. Be assured that during this time of your bereavement, that our prayers are with you and will continue for you as you grapple with life without the physical presence of your loved one. We also grieve as a faith community of which our brother was a part, and we give thanks to God for the ways in which his life would have been a blessing to our lives. And we thank God for the opportunities given during the latter years of his life for us to exercise our home ministry to him. So on behalf of the Care Fund stewards who ensured that the minister visited regularly and administered the sacrament of the Lord's Supper, those were for us tremendous times of great fellowship and worship and mutual encouragement and witness to the grace and the love of God. So we bless God for you and pray that God will continue to journey with you, that the ways in which God surrounded and upheld our brother, that you will also be assured that the same God is with you and the same God will do for you and in you what God has done for so many others who have journeyed through this life. Our brother William was an extraordinary photographer, and during his career would have captured some of the most historic and memorable moments in the life and history of Barbados, and also in the life of many families during their times of great celebrations and bereavement, in their good times and in their difficult and challenging times. He would have been there to capture those moments and therefore to help many of us recall history and to help many of us to bear with the memories of life. And so we thank God for his work, for the legacy that he has left behind, and for the capturing of history. Because of him, there are some things that we will never forget, because the photographs are there to constantly remind us and to encourage us to be all that we can be. And so as I reflected on his life as an individual, as a Christian, and as a photographer, I thought about what is one of the messages in Scripture that is captured as a photographer would capture it. What would be one of those photo perfect narratives in Scripture? And the Spirit of the Lord led me to Revelation chapter 7, verse 9 following. And I want to lift up this portion of Scripture for our brief reflection today. And here John, who had a vision from God, a vision of heaven, a vision of life beyond this world. This is how John captured that moment and that vision that was given to him. He says, after this, I looked and there was a great multitude that no one could count, from every nation, from all tribes and peoples and languages, standing before the throne and before the Lamb, robed in white, with palm branches in their hands. They cried out in a loud voice, saying, salvation belongs to our God, who is seated on the throne, and to the Lamb. And all the angels stood around the throne and around the elders and the four living creatures. And they fell on their faces before the throne and worshipped God, saying, amen. Blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be to our God forever and ever. Then one of the elders addressed me, saying, who are these robed in white and where have they come from? I said to him, sir, you are the one that knows. Then he said to me, these are they who have come out of the great ordeal. They have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. Let us pray. Oh God, we bless you and we give you thanks for your word and for capturing this moment for us, this picture perfect moment of life beyond this world. We pray now that you'd speak to us in ways that we will understand. Speak now in this moment and speak through me. So let the words of my mouth and the reflections of our hearts be pleasing in your sight, God, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. And so as John on the Isle of Patmos, banished because of his faith in Jesus Christ, trapped on this island as his prison, in a moment that seems so hopeless, in a moment where it seems as though it is all over, a moment where it seems as though he had lost, where it seems as though the enemy of the cross of Jesus Christ have won, God intervened in that moment, and God shows John a picture, just a picture, of what is, a picture of what will be, a picture of that which is hidden, a picture of that which cannot be seen by the natural eyes, a picture of that which is magnified when looked at through the lens of faith. And so what was supposed to be a discouraging moment turns into a moment of hope,
not just for the Apostle Paul, not just for John the Apostle, but for every believer who will follow him, who will get a glimpse of this picture that God has shown him. It is a picture of great hope, that when you think all is over, God shows you where God is now beginning. That when you think that it is all lost and doomed, God shows you through the magnifying eyes of faith of what God is doing. I want us for a moment to notice three things that are captured in this picture. Three things that cannot be missed through the eyes of faith, through the lens of faith. First of all, what we see in this picture is a multitude, a large number of people captured in one shot. A large number of people who are varied in their looks, in their ages. According to John, as he looks at this picture, he concludes that there are people from every tribe, from every nation, and from every language. As he looks at this picture, he notices that there are people of varying ages, but they're all dressed in white, and they're all before the throne and before the Lamb, and they are in worship. They are worshiping the Lamb. They are singing. They are giving adoration to the Lamb. John was asked, can you identify this group? Do you know who they are and where they have come from? And John says to the angel, you know who they are. The angel said to him, these are they who have come through the great ordeal, who have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. And now they're around the throne of God, and because they're around the throne of God, they will no longer experience pain. They will no longer experience death. They are the redeemed of the Lord. These are they who have come through. No doubt, as John looks closely at this picture, John notices that these are people that he knew from this side of eternity. He recognized that they are people he walked with and people he worshipped with. He noticed that they were some partners in ministry. He noticed that there are some persons that he had long conversations with, that he knew intimately. Others he knew only in passing, yet there were others that he knew their names and he knew something about their faith. But what is interesting about this picture and about this group of people is that they have died. But when John looks at the picture closely, John recognized that even though he knew them as persons who had died on this side of eternity, that they are not dead, that they are alive. And so John discovers that this picture is teaching something about eternity, that people who are in Christ, who fall asleep in this life, that people who are in Christ, who come to the end of their earthly journey on this side of eternity, that when the cameras begin to roll on the other side of eternity, that these dead people on this side of eternity are alive on the other side of eternity, because on that side of eternity, death has no dominion over them. Death has no power over them. Death has been defeated. Jesus Christ has already taken the sting out of death, and therefore for these persons, contrary to the view on this side of eternity, the grave is not their destination. The grave cannot hold them. On the other side of eternity, they are resurrected. They are alive and well and around the throne of God. And there is no doubt in my mind, my brothers and sisters, that William is familiar with the reality of this picture. John only gets a shot. William now gets to live among the large crowd of witnesses. William is now numbered among those who are dressed in white, among those who have journeyed through this life and has made it safely into eternity. No doubt, as I said, as John looks at the picture, John recognizes that there are some familiar faces. And because this picture is dynamic, the faces, new faces are being added from day to day. And I submit to us today, my brothers and sisters, that if you were to look at this picture again, you'd notice that William is among them. That William is numbered among those who have come through, those who have made it safe on the other side. What this says to us, therefore, is that death is not the end of those who believe in God and have trusted Jesus Christ with their life and their salvation. What this says to us, my brothers and sisters, is that how we live on this side of eternity has implications for beyond this life. That when we live honestly and authentically to serve and worship God, to be all that God has created us to become, according to the Apostle Paul in Romans 8, not even death can separate us from the love of God, which is in Jesus Christ our Lord. There is a second thing I want to point you to in this picture. John says to us that he notices that at the center of the throne, that there is a lamb, that there is the lamb. And as far as John is concerned, this lamb is no other than Jesus the Christ. This lamb is no other than Jesus, who suffered and bled and died on Calvary. The lamb is no other than Jesus, who broke open the tomb and was raised to new life. The lamb is none other than Jesus, who has ascended to the Father and is seated at the right hand of God, making intercession for us. According to John, the lamb is none other than Jesus, who is the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last, the beginning and the end. According to John, the lamb is none other than the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, the one who is seated on the throne and will reign forever and forever. John captures the Lamb on the throne. There are some persons who go through this life and they try to avoid and evade Jesus. They want nothing to do with Jesus. They live only for themselves. They deny the power of Jesus to save and to redeem. They avoid hearing his word, and when they do hear his word of invitation to salvation, they dismiss it, they postpone it, or they become very indifferent to Jesus. There are some who are simply indifferent to Jesus, but yet there are others who take on Jesus and seek to criticize Jesus and seek to devalue Jesus and seek to dismiss Jesus and seek to make Jesus a lie. There are those who go as far as to deny that Jesus is the Son of God, the Savior of the world. And the truth is that we may get away on this side of eternity to avoid, to denounce, to deny Jesus. But look again. John is saying that while we may try to escape Jesus on this side of eternity, we are going to be confronted with the very presence of Jesus in death and beyond death. And therefore, we cannot avoid Jesus indefinitely. The thing is that when we do encounter Jesus on beyond this life in eternity, we no longer have a choice. We no longer can determine whether we want to be with him or against him, because we would have already made up our minds on this side of eternity. Jesus told an interesting parable about a rich man and a poor man. And Jesus says that the rich man treated the poor man with very scant regard. The poor man was hungry and the rich man gave him nothing, but the poor man was able to get the crumbs that fell from the rich man's table, and even that was a problem. But both of them died. The rich man was sent to a place of torment. The poor man was in the arms of Abraham. But this is the interesting part that I want to get to. When the rich man recognized his fate, he said, "Father Abraham, can you send him, Lazarus, to at least dip his finger in water and cool my thirst?" When that was not possible, hear him now. "Can you at least send him back to warn my brothers, so that they will not end up in this place?" Because he recognized that his fate was already sealed by the decisions that he made on this side of eternity. And so I am saying to us that when we look at this picture, we cannot avoid the presence, the person of Jesus. Jesus says to Thomas, who asks, "Lord, we don't know where you're going. How do we know the way?" Jesus says, "I am. I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." Brothers and sisters, Jesus is saying, you cannot get to the Father unless you make up your mind what you're going to do with Jesus. Some people say, "But Rev, there are many ways to the same place." And I say, it's a lie from the pit of hell. Jesus says, "I am the only way." Jesus says, "I am the only truth." Jesus says, "I am that only path to the Father." Again, I rejoice in the fact that William discovered this truth on this side of eternity. When William was no longer able to endure an hour or 2 hour services, he came to this place faithfully every Sunday evening.
at 5:30 for that 1 hour service with Holy Communion on the first Sunday. And that was the extent of his devotion, not to church, but to Jesus. That was the extent of his Christianity, not just in words, but backed up by a life devoted to Jesus. Thirdly and finally, the third thing that John captures in this picture is a place. The picture is situated in a particular place. John says, around the throne of God. When we read scripture, the only conclusion we can come to is that this place, this picture, is situated in heaven. This picture is located in heaven. The background to this picture is the throne of God. So I am saying to you, therefore, that the reality of heaven and hell are real. They are not figment of somebody's imagination. It is not true to say that heaven is here. And I'm not going to say to you that I know the geographical location of heaven. I am not going to say to you that heaven is up there or out there, because the truth is, I don't know. But what I do know is that heaven is where God has set up his throne. That heaven is where God rules supreme over the whole universe. I am submitting to you that heaven is real because the angel of the Lord gave John a glimpse, a vision into a place, a reality where life continues, where people are active, where people are alert, but where God himself is in the center. And when we read on in Revelation, we notice that the sun in heaven is the Lord himself, where his glory shines so bright that there is no need for a planet called sun, because the presence of the Lord fills the place. And it is light forever. There's no longer night and day, because the sun, S-O-N, shines brightly. My brothers and sisters, I want to encourage while at the same time challenge you today that all of us young and old, must pass through the valley of the shadow of death. All of us, sick or well, will pass through the valley of the shadow of death. Tragically, or being in a place of comfort, will pass through the valley of the shadow of death. But I love what the psalmist says, even though I go through the valley of the shadow of death, I shall fear no evil. Why? Because God is with me. His rod and his staff will comfort me. We bless God for William's life. We bless God for this picture perfect moment. But while we are looking at a photograph, he is experiencing the reality of the persons who are gathered around the throne. He's experiencing the reality of the one who is seated on the throne. He's experiencing the reality of this place where it is all happening. May God give us grace so that we too will live and die in the Lord. Amen. Let us just spend a moment in quiet reflection and prayer as we allow God to paint in our mind's eyes
picture of our present reality, so that we know what changes we may need to make in our own lives, so that the picture of our future can be in line with the picture that John was given and the reality that Willie has inherited. And so, God, into your hands, we commend our reflections, our thoughts, our lives. And we pray that your Spirit will so move us and woo us to a place where we can surrender our life and our all to the Lordship of Jesus. So speak now, O God, in living echoes of your tone, and may we, in obedience to your will, submit and commit to being all that you've called us to be. In Christ Jesus we pray. Amen. The hymn, through all the changing scenes of life, in trouble and in joy, the praises of my God shall still my heart and tongue employ. Let us rise as we sing to the glory of God.
Friends, I invite us to remain standing as we affirm our faith as we engage the Apostles' Creed. It's on page number 6 on our leaflets. Together, I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. Friends, please be seated for prayer. So let us pray. Praise be to you, O God, our Father, who created us in your own image for eternal fellowship with you. Praise and thanksgiving to you, O Christ, our Lord and our God, who have overcome the sharpness of death and opened the kingdom of heaven to all believers, and are now seated at the right hand of God in the glory of the Father. Praise and blessing be to you, O Holy Spirit, God our Comforter, who bear witness within us of our acceptance with the Father, and have become the pledge of eternal inheritance. All praise and glory, blessing and honor, thanksgiving and worship be to you, O Blessed Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Lord, bless you for the life of our dear brother William, who today we lay to rest. We give you thanks for the joy and the blessing his life has brought to others, for his service to his generation, according to your will, and for every happy remembrance of his life. We bless you for your mercy and goodness, which have followed him all the days of his life, that now the trials of this world are over, and death itself is past. Receive him into your perfect kingdom, and bring us with all who have lived and served you faithfully to the fullness of your eternal joy, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
I invite you to stand again with me for the commendation and Lord's Prayer. Eternal God, who have made us all and hate nothing that you have made, and have given your Son for our redemption, we commend our brother William Eustace Allen to your perfect mercy and wisdom. Eternal rest grant unto him, and let perpetual light shine upon him. Amen. The Lord's Prayer. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive them that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Brothers and sisters, let me on your behalf say special thanks to Reverend Nicholas Chambers, one of our ministers here, who has assisted with this service. Also to our organist, Brother Ryan Boyce, the James Street Methodist Church Choir, or part of, the hospitality stewards, and all those who would have ensured the smooth running of this service. The live stream is being done by Trident 10, and we thank them for their ministry. We sing our closing hymn as we continue to celebrate the life of our brother William, the great hymn of the faith. We call it the Methodist Anthem, and can it be that I should gain an interest in the Savior's blood? Died he for me who caused this pain, for me who him to death pursue. Amazing love. How can it be that thou, my God, shouldst die for me? Let us lift our voices and worship the Lamb.
Thank you.
receive the benediction. So my brothers and sisters, now the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus Christ, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant make you perfect in every good thing to do his will, working in you that which is well-pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be the glory forever and ever. And the people of God say, Amen and Amen. Brothers and sisters, please remain standing as we prepare to lead the body out of the church for the final time. The choir will go first, and then we ask that the pallbearers take their position, and then the recession will begin.
As a father pities his children, so the Lord pities those who fear him. For he knows our frame. He remembers that we are dust. As for man, his days are as grass, as the flower of the field, so he flourishes. For the wind passes over it, and it is gone, and the place thereof shall know it no more. But the mercy of the Lord is from everlasting to everlasting upon those who fear him, and his righteousness to his children's children. As a father pities his children, so the Lord pities those who fear him, for he knows our frame. He remembers that we are dust. As for man, his days are as grass. As a flower of the field, so he flourishes. For the wind passes over it, and it is gone, and the place thereof shall know it no more.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before. Oh my soul, I worship Your holy name. The sun comes up. It's a new day dawning. It's time to sing Your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Your holy name. You're rich in love and You're slow to anger. Your name is great and Your heart is kind. For all Your goodness I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. So bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh my soul, worship His holy name. Your holy name. Bless You, time has come. Still my soul will sing Your praise unending. 10,000 years and then His holy name. Sing like never before. Oh my soul, I worship Your holy name. Come on, bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh my soul, worship His holy. Worship Your holy name, Lord, I worship Your holy name. Sing like never. Your holy name.
So, brothers and sisters, we will continue in this act of worship. We know that neither death, nor life, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature can separate us from the love of God, which is in Jesus Christ our Lord. We know that if this earthly house of our tabernacle be dissolved, we have a building from God, a house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. Since our brother has departed out of this life, and Almighty God, in his mercy, has taken him to himself, we therefore commit his body to the ground, dust to dust, ashes to ashes, earth to earth, in the sure and certain hope of the resurrection to eternal life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the path of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I shall fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of my enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely, goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord my whole life long. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Let us pray. I heard a voice from heaven saying unto me, from henceforth, blessed are the dead who die in the Lord. Even so says the Spirit, for they rest from their labors. O merciful God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, Father of mercies and God of all comfort, raise us up, we pray, from death of sin to the new life of righteousness, that when we shall depart this life, we shall be found acceptable in your sight. This we pray through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Grant to the bereaved, to Brother William's children, grandchildren and great-grandchildren, other relatives and friends, consolation and faith in this time of distress and trial, the blessed hope in the coming of your kingdom, the sustaining grace in the fellowship of your people, and steadfastness in the service of your name and the doing of your will, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Support us, O Lord, all the day long of this troublous life, until the shadows lengthen, the evening comes, the busy world is hushed, the fever of life is over, and our work is done. Then, Lord, in your mercy, grant unto us safe lodging, holy rest, and peace at the last, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen and amen. Sing the wondrous love of Jesus, sing his mercy and his grace. In the mansions bright and blessed, he'll prepare for us a place when we all get to heaven. What a day of rejoicing that will be.
Sing the wondrous love of Jesus, sing his mercy.
When we all get to heaven.
or when the saints go marching in. Oh Lord, I want to be in that number when the saints go marching in.
Loved the Savior, what a soldier he had been. But his steps will be more steady when the saints go marching in.
Tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go and tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ is born.
Go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ is born. While shepherds kept their watching over silent flock by night, all throughout the heavens, they shone a holy light. Oh, go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Oh, go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ is born. Christ was born. God sent us salvation on that blessed Christmas morn. Don't tell it on the mountain, over the hills, everywhere. Oh, don't tell.
I love you, Lord, for your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hand. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. 'Cause all my life you have been faithful, and all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire, and in darkest night you are close like no other. I've known you as a father, I've known you as a friend, and I have lived in the goodness of God. Hey! 'Cause all my life you have been faithful.
Oh, yes, you have.
And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, I surrender now. I give you everything, oh Lord. Your goodness is running after.
Brothers and sisters, let us pronounce a benediction together. May the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, now and forevermore. Amen.
I wanted you for life. You and me in the wind. I never thought there'd come a time that our story would end. It's hard to understand, but I guess I'll have to try. It's not easy to say goodbye. For all the joy we shared, all that time we had to spend. Now if I had one wish, I'd want forever back again. Into your eyes and hold you when you cry. It's not easy to say goodbye. I can remember all those great times we had. There were so many memories, some good, some bad. Yes, and through it all, those memories will last forever. There's peace in where you are. Maybe all I need to know. And if I listen to my heart, I'll hear your laughter once more. And so I've got to say, I'm just glad you came my way. Not easy to say goodbye.